us at Pole Pole, where Dorcas Vinkovic shows us a new perspective of what the African community is doing now.
Australia, welcome to another epic episode of Oz African TV. I'm Dorcas Utkovic, and thank you so much for joining me right here at Pole Pole. Today we're celebrating art, and I will be joined by some amazing Melbourne-based artists. Tamirat Gebremariam is here to chat about his impressive larger-than-life paintings. Also coming through is the visionary artist Bonny Hut. But let's start with Lisa Minogue, a photographer with a great eye for colour, right after we check in with Chef Stoli to see what he's got in store for us. Come with me. Hey, Chef Stoli.
Hi.
What are you making today?
Today I'm making Mauritian fry bread.
You can cook with us by jumping on our website to download your recipe and shopping list with ingredients that you can buy from your local supermarket. Also, don't forget to let us know your thoughts about today's show on social media using hashtag OzAfricanTV, OzAfrica, and A New Perspective.
Mm-hmm. So this is a dish my mother used to make for me and my brothers, and we absolutely love it still to this day. Yeah. And it's just gone on the menu at Pole Pole.
Oh, yum. Well, I'll leave you to do that, and I'll check in with you a little bit later. But for now, let's go back to the tent to meet my first guest. My first guest is not only passionate about creating incredible images, but Lisa has the kindest and biggest heart. She joins me now to talk about her latest exhibition titled The Coloured Girls. Hi, Lisa.
Hello.
I'm so happy that you're here.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. What an amazing opportunity.
Thank you, thank you. Now, your exhibition at 45 Downstairs, the title of it is quite bold.
Very bold.
Do you want to tell me how you arrived at it?
I wish I could say I arrived at it. For me, as an artist, as a photographic artist, ideas come to me. And some of them are daunting, and this was probably the most daunting. When the words came for the title, the concept was fine, but when the words came to me for the title, I thought, I can't say that. Can I say that? I don't think I can say that. And then I realised if I didn't know I could say it, then it needed to be the title because that's what needed to be discussed.
And was did anyone think it was going to be offensive at all?
Not so much offensive. The thing is, depending on where you were born, where you were raised, how old you are, words have different value, weight, and meaning. Mm. So what I found was young people had no problem whatsoever with it. Older people had more thought behind it. It was more of something they had to think about. Mm-hmm. I also noticed that people that were from the US had a little bit more time to think about what would the ramifications of that be. Mm. So it was great. It was actually exactly the right title because it started the discussion before the images were shot.
And when you did the images, they're so powerful and all those beautiful faces, beautifully captured. With the colours that you chose, did you choose them with the girls, the colours that you use on their faces, or was it just purely an artistic decision from your end?
So all of the girls were chosen specifically because they'd been in my life whilst I studied, for the 4 years that I studied, and they had given me so much. So for me, it was a chance to give back to them. And as a part of that, they must be a part of the creative process. Mm-hmm. So it was important to me that they were given an opportunity to suggest colours to me. However, as you can imagine, with 15 images, I needed to have, it needed to be broad. Not everyone could be yellow. Yeah, yeah. So I asked people to choose their top three. Mm. And usually everyone got the colour more or less that they liked. Towards the end, it got a little bit more difficult. But, I liked their input on what colour they felt they wanted to express.
Nice. So I know that each image of the girls is accompanied by some words written by these girls, and that's quite special to you and the girls in a collaborative process. Do you want to tell me a little bit about that?
The imagery is mine. It's how I wanted to present a series of images. However, the coloured girls begs the question, what are we looking at? What do we think? What do they think? And it was really important to me that every subject spoke and explained to the viewer, what does it mean for me to be called a coloured girl? And I can't tell that story. I have no right to that story, But the women I work with or I've met over the years, they have so much to say, and it was really important to me that that became a part of the exhibition.
Do you ever worry about cultural appropriation at all?
All the time. All the time. I'm so mindful of it because it's a real thing, and it's something that needs to be addressed constantly. And as a white woman, I don't have the right to take anything and say it's mine. But there is a thing called cultural exchange, and that's something I think I work with, and I would like to hope that once people have seen the imagery, they can see. Mm. It's important that two cultures together, you know, we can exchange the energy, exchange the information. I have the information. Mm. I have a skill or a talent, if you will, to photograph people, and that's really important. It's something I love to do. Mm-hmm. And I want to exchange that with my subject. It's a collaboration. It's not me, you know, saying you do this, you do that. Yeah. It's, hey, how can we work together? So, but I am extremely mindful of cultural appropriation, and we do need to be careful about that.
What do you want to say to any photographers out there or any artists who want to, just like you, you know, do a cultural exchange, work together with different people just to show our diverse community in that?
I think make sure your intentions are sincere. I think it's really important that we don't ever step into another community and just take what we want for our own benefit. If your intentions are good, that will show, and that will be what you produce.
Thank you so much for coming and joining me. I really appreciate it. And I'll see you at the exhibition.
Thank you very much.
Awesome. And remember, if you want to find out about the guests from today's episode, feel free to jump onto our website. We'll put some links there. And also while you're there, you can connect with us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Right now, let's go back to the kitchen and check what Chef Stoli is doing. Hey.
Hey.
How are you going?
Well, I've prepped the veggies and just mixing up the batter now.
Uh-huh. And you are using stale bread, right?
Yes. The stale bread is actually the key to this dish. It helps hold the batter and is a great way to make use of old bread.
Of course. Recycling. While you do that, I'm going to go back to the tent to speak with my next guest. We all know that art is meant to evoke something within the viewer. Now, if you're looking for art that can transport you to the realms of infinite possibilities of thought and ideas, look no further, because today I'm joined by the Johannesburg-born Bonny Hut, who's here to talk about her visionary art, which features alongside her poetry in her book entitled The Exploration of the Mirror. Thank you for coming through, Bonny.
Thanks for having me.
Well, my first question is, what is visionary art? That's your style of painting, so what is it?
A lot of it's got a slightly more etheric edge to it because of the mish technique that a lot of the visionary artists use. It's a very layered method. Uh-huh. The materials they use are quite different to that of the old masters. I suppose I paint in a more traditional method.
Yes, that's more like it.
Yes, yeah. Yes, where the colour that I'm using is the colour that goes on the painting.
Mm-hmm. How long does it take to get one finished? And you know, you show the process in your book as well, and you can see where it starts and where it finishes. How intense is that process?
Generally speaking, my latest works, because they are so detailed, take between 6 and 8 months to finish one painting.
Do people have to be spiritually awakened or, you know, be interested in that sort of stuff to begin to appreciate your work or to understand your work, the subject matter in it?
My main primary kind of goal is just to touch a person's soul.
Yeah.
You know, through painting work that's quite emotive, quite deep work, that stirs someone emotionally rather than painting a pretty picture.
Yeah. And, you know, as I touched on when I introduced you, your work travels, you know, it takes the viewer into that space, that realm of telling people that there's infinite possibilities out there. And even your the first words in your book, The Exploration of the Mirror, alludes to the idea that whatever it is that we're looking for in the world, you know, from the worldly material, it already lives in us. It's in our soul. You know, how do you go about that? How, you know, what does that mean to you?
Well, basically, yes, it's about getting the answers from within, mm-hmm. having an internal point of reference for what we think and what we, how we perceive the world. And of course, in commercial society today, it's all about having an external point of reference for mm-hmm. everything we think and who we are. And, you know, because that's the way that they can sell more stuff.
Yeah.
By telling you what you need and by yeah. telling you what you're supposed to think.
Mm-hmm.
So, and one of the ways to just gain more internal reflection is, of course, just through silence and just through simply walking, you know, in a forest for an hour.
Yeah. You painted a portrait of Nelson Mandela from a poster that you got. Was it on the election, the first elections?
Yes.
Yeah.
We climbed up the pole after the elections and brought the poster down.
Mm-hmm.
there were obviously at that time hundreds of thousands of posters.
Yeah.
Of course, those posters would probably be quite valuable today.
Oh, yes.
But yeah, and I just painted him, and yeah, it was a very interesting time.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, I mean, at that time I was quite young and I wasn't that much into politics or anything, but we were all like wondering how, you know, amazing change, and yeah, it was just a fascinating,
it was
just vibrant, unbelievable time.
I know, because I was quite young myself, and I remember on the voting day, I lived near school, my parents' house in Pretoria, shout out, and so the votes, where the voting station was at the school, and the queue was incredible. It was like, oh my goodness. I wasn't voting or anything. I was just like, oh my God, what's going on here? And you just, I didn't understand the politics at the time, but I just understood that it was a very important time and there was this vibe going on and, you know, change was happening. So it was really good. So, you know, to be able to paint that and have that with you must be amazing as well.
Yeah, because at that time I was in first year uni.
Yeah.
And we had no African people in the university. And, yeah, by the fourth year, it yeah. was completely changed. It was amazing.
Yeah. Yeah, all the cultures, all the people that have always been there. Isn't it funny?
Yes, all the richness, all the new talents.
Yeah.
The new painters. It was yeah. new drama students. It was fantastic.
Yeah, awesome. Good times.
Yes, totally.
Cool. Thank you so much, Bonny, for joining me.
Thank you.
Coming up next, we branch out a little from the visual arts to celebrate a great performing artist, Nadia Idris.
Okay? Do small. And we go.
Nadia is one of Australia's top quality performers, choreographers, and educators. Through her unique style of dance hall, she was recognized on Australia's biggest dance stage, the multi-award winning TV series, So You Think You Can Dance Australia, where she finished in the top 20 of season 4. She had a chat with Nkechi and Lucy of The Pin to discuss the issues surrounding biracial identity.
Growing up in Malaysia, it was really, really challenging. One of the biggest challenges was the fact that kids sometimes wanted to be my friend because I was different. Like, that was the cool thing one day, and the next day, people didn't want to be a friend because I was different. So it's like being different was a plus, and then it was a benefit. Everyone was like, no, you're the weird one because you look different.
But Nadia's identity goes way deeper than her biracial makeup, and she uses dance as a vehicle to explore her personal journey.
It's actually a really massive part of my life. In fact, I can't even say part of my life. I'd say it is who I am, and it's the thing that actually really helped me get through the struggles that I was going through when I was growing up. It's my way to relay messages of happiness, sadness, frustration, anger, all the emotions you can think of when I can't put it into words, like, especially when I can't put it into words, because what I tell people a lot of the time is, like, you can get to know me on a verbal level, hanging out with me, all that kind of stuff. But if you really, really want to know me, or like really want to know what I'm all about, or feel my vibe, or feel my story, just watch me dance in a freestyle situation. And that's me, that's who I am, that's my pure soul right there.
Said I'd be gone by five, but it's sunrise and I'm still in your bed. Good night, you sleep means goodbye. Me replaying memories in my head. Look at you, look at you, look what you made me do. How do you figure my every move? Who are you, you look so familiar. I know you, baby, I know the truth. We got way too much in common. Somebody like me, you wanna love somebody like me. If you could love somebody like me, you must be Mr. Home too. Who wants to love somebody like me? You wanna love somebody like me. If you could love somebody like me, you must be Mr. Home too. We used to talk till midnight, all those days that you stayed at my house. We were just passing the time. When we were young and we ain't had no vows. Nah, 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 maybe later on I'll text you and maybe you'll reply. We both know we had no patience together day and night. Get an eye on our supply and we ain't satisfied. I could love you all occasions.
Just like the impressive size of his canvases, Tamirat's work explores big ideas surrounding migration and identity. And he joins me now to tell me more about his art. Thank you for coming, Tamirat.
Thank you for having me.
Now, your canvases, I saw them when I first got to Australia. They are ginormous. Does this feed into your work, into your practice? Is there a specific reason why you paint so big?
Normally I paint big. I prefer large canvas and to explore in the way I'm doing and explore my idea, especially to transform into big gesture. Mm-hmm. That makes me more comfortable.
So you're comfortable, going all gestural and making big marks on the canvas.
Yes, physically and ideally also to put that together, and I prefer in larger scale.
Okay, and tell me about your body of work entitled Faces, where you explore the idea of moving from one place to the other. How did you come up with that idea?
When I'm transitioning from one place to another, for example, from Ethiopia, I'm from Ethiopia, I went to Egypt and staying there, and I come to Australia. I'm moving around, and I found myself finding to express with faces. That's a feature of us.
So do you use your face but embody other people's faces around you,
or
to show your movement from one place to the other? Is that what the whole idea is?
Yes, that's a kind of changing landscape. Mm-hmm. When you move around and when you return back, and everything's changed, and capturing the and the moment, and using my self-portrait and to express what's my surround.
Yes. And you also painted about Black Saturday, a very significant time in Australia. Why did you feel the need to do that work?
That's more more sensitive and more touching, and a kind of a tragedy, the human being and nature.
Yeah.
And when you have some skill also, how do you express that moment? Yeah, and I chose that subject just to express my feeling.
How did you go about doing your work? Did you actually go to the place and speak to people who have been through the tragedy, the bushfires and that, or how did you go about that?
I just set up my camera and sketchbook and went to Marysville. I just driven there and capturing the moment. I mean, which means after disaster. And after I collect some evidence, and I just translate to in my way
what's
the result of that disaster.
Huh. Yeah. And you've been acknowledged by Celebration of African Australian as one of the 100 people who are doing wonderful things in the African community in Australia. How important do you think it is for all of us to acknowledge, you know, each other and actually say, hey, you're doing a good job? How important do you think is that for all of us?
That's very important for all of us, especially for a younger generation. That's a kind of a cultural exchange, actually. And the sharing what we have, and also we have good things. We have a skill, and mm-hmm. we have acknowledged, and mm-hmm. There's so many people with skill living here and serving the community, mm-hmm. and that's very important to acknowledging and. What's behind the African community and what are we expecting for the future.
Yeah, that's great to see how you're contributing to the society. And this, you know, like you said, when they acknowledge you at Celebration of African Australians, it's things like what you're doing, you know, giving back to the community, going to study and doing all that kind of stuff and creating wonderful work. I wish you all the best in everything that you do, and I look forward to your next work.
Thank you very much.
Now I am going to the kitchen to check with Chef Stolly. Oh my goodness, this looks amazing.
Thank you very much. And instead of bread,
yeah.
you can also use any veggies you have laying around. So me and my brothers, we like to use eggplant and sweet potato.
Awesome. This dish is all about recycling the stuff that you have in the kitchen. But to you, thank you so much for joining me today. I can't wait to be back here again next time. And for everything that we did on the show today and to find out about our guest, be sure to jump on our website. See you soon. Love and light.
Yard House Production.